Please join us as we sing Fill Me Now and Indescribable.
Oh, As God has blessed us richly with gifts, let us return our gifts to God. And this morning, Kathy Dawson is going to share a gift of a poem.
It's short, so I'll read the poem. Touched by an angel. We, unaccustomed to courage, exiles from delight, live coiled in shells of loneliness until love leaves its high holy temple and comes into our sight to liberate us into life. Love arrives, and in its train comes ecstasies, old memories of pleasure, ancient histories of pain. Yet if we are bold, love strikes away the chains of fear from our souls. We are weaned from our timidity in the flush of love's light. We dare be brave, and suddenly we see that love costs all we are and will ever be. Yet it is only love which sets us free.
Let's bow our heads together in prayer. Loving God, it's such a beautiful day out there. The sunshine is incredible. It's warm upon our bodies. Its bright rays make everything seem more beautiful. The flowers are just a little more colorful. The grass seems a little greener. The colors of the houses and the decorations seem a little more joyful. We give you thanks for this wonderful gift. The sun's warm rays are starting to warm up the soil. The soil receives that warmth and gives it to the seeds and helps them germinate, helps them to grow. The warmth permeates into us, helps us to shed off the memories of a long, hard winter, warms our souls, and seems to make us more joyful and more alive. The sun's energy drives our planet. The light, the heat that strike the surface of the earth help the cycles of weather to take place, help the very cycles of life to occur. And we give you thanks for this tremendous gift. Perhaps what's most astounding is that the sun itself is far too hot, far too dangerous a place to sustain life. If we were any closer, we would boil up. The earth would be destroyed. There would be nothing. If we were any further away, we would be too cold, perhaps not even within the gravitational field, and so our planet would drift off. But you, God, have placed the sun and the earth at just the right distance, have set the conditions so that life can exist here, and from what we understand so far, here alone. And you have given us life not just to be your creatures or playthings. You have not just invented us to be robots, but you meant us to worship you, to enjoy you, to glorify you. And yet, even here, it is not the relationship of a mighty king sitting on a lofty throne, looking over his subjects and expecting them to do wonders. No, you call yourself our Father. Through your Son, Jesus, we have been made your children, brothers and sisters to him and to one another. So you are all wise, you are all knowing, you are all powerful. You have set the sun in just the right place. You have created the right conditions on earth. But you have done so as a God who is our Father, our parent. And we give you thanks for this gift. We realize, God, that as your children, you like us a lot. You love us even more. But sometimes we frustrate you. We might even drive you a little crazy with our behavior. And so we ask for your forgiveness for those times that we have hurt you, hurt our creation, or hurt one another. And through our brother Jesus, we receive the gift of your total forgiveness, of the cleansing that he alone can offer. And by the power of your wisdom, of your Holy Spirit, you pray that you help us to be better children, that you help us to understand our relationship more clearly, and that you help us to frustrate you a little less and to give you a little more joy. We pray these things in the name of our brother Jesus, and we share together the words of prayer that he first taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And I'm going to invite Kathy Langridge to share our first reading.
The reading is from Luke 15, verses 11 to 32. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his field to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him. My son, the father said, you were always with me and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.
We're going to sing again.
Thank you.
The second reading is from John 14, verses 1 to 3. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am.
Challenging passages today. The first one, the story of a prodigal son, is a long story, and it's one that's often not told in its entirety. A lot of times, people will cut the story off just when it gets interesting. The son who has squandered half of his father's wealth, the son who has embarrassed himself, not just to his parents, but to the entire community, the son who is, to use an old term, a reprobate, comes back home, The Father sees him. The Son isn't even all the way down the line, laneway yet, and the Father sees him and he runs out. And there's a party and it's wonderful, and the story ends. The story ends with rejoicing. The story ends, isn't this wonderful, that Dad forgave his Son who was such a lousy Son? And we all feel good. Oh, that's nice. And we leave the story there. But Jesus didn't leave the story there. Jesus went on to describe the brother. The brother who saw this reprobate son waste half of the family fortune, saw this great party, and there he is toiling in the fields, faithful to his father, manages the money well, makes sure the crop comes in on time, takes care of the hired workers, ensures that everything works. Tickety-boo. I like that phrase. Does a great job. And what does he get? What does he get? Nothing. No parties, no fattened calf, no fine robe, no ring. He doesn't get dinners that Sunday that are fully laden with all kinds of food. He doesn't wake up in the morning knowing that he's got a meal coming to him. He doesn't have a steady job. He doesn't have lots of money. He doesn't have a father that loves him. Every story starts falling apart, doesn't it? But we leave this story out because the kid's angry. He can't accept the fact that his father has embraced this reprobate son, and we cut this story out. We leave the most important part of the story out, where reality happens. Now let's face it, we've all been in situations where that jerk in the classroom that's always talking loud, how did he get the scholarship? That politician that seems worthless gets elected. The TV star that does one good thing gets recognized. Meanwhile, you're slogging away at school and you're doing your assignments, and okay, they're not quite perfect, but they come in on time and the teacher never notices you. And you're at work and you're working away and you don't get a promotion, and you always do charitable work and you give your tithe faithfully, and nobody ever pastes your picture on the newspaper. We leave this part of the story out. That's really the us about this story. I mean, most of us are in that situation of being the average folks who are kind of left behind. Nothing exciting ever happens to us. And so we miss out on the most important part of the story. We miss out on the Father making it clear why it is that he did what he did. I always have you with me, kid. You're always around. Every morning we wake up together. We pray together, we have breakfast together, we enjoy each other's company. Every morning we go out into the fields together. I go do my work, you do yours, we get together for lunch. We go to church on Sunday, we have a family meal on Sunday, we go to hockey games together. I've got you every day. How much more special does it need to be than that? But the Son misses it. He's angry. He's jealous. But the story's not about him. But we have to recognize him. We have to acknowledge him. We have to understand his part there. Because so often, we forget that forgiveness involves two parts. You know what the two parts of forgiving are? Forgive and forget. I'm glad you remembered that. That's good. But we so often forget the importance of forgetting. Because forgiveness without forgetting is just lip service. If you forgive that guy that cut you off in traffic and then continue cursing him every time you see him, "I remember what you did," you haven't forgiven him at all. If you see that guy get a promotion and you don't think he deserves it, and maybe he cheated a little bit to get it, and you say, "I forgive you," when he acknowledges the fact, "Oh, you know what, maybe you should have got that promotion," but then you forever hold a grudge, you never forget it. You always tell your friends, "I forgave him. I was the bigger person. I forgave." You know what? You remember old Jones who got the promotion? "I forgave him." On your day, on your tombstone, "I forgave Jones." Is that forgiveness? No. Forgiveness includes forgetting. And what the father does for the prodigal son is he wipes the slate clean. It wipes the slate clean by having the party. He starts it all over again. He closes the one chapter and opens a new one. He says, "All that's gone. We're going to celebrate your return. The lost has been found." And that's what we're going to remember. But the brother keeps holding a grudge. And the brother is probably more like us than we are like the father. Let's face it. We have a hard time forgetting. And in an ideal society, in an ideal world, the forgetting would take place. There would be, I'm going to step out of the diving board and jump in here, but there would be no punishment. There would be no jails. There would be no reformatories. There would be no penitentiaries. Because crimes would be forgiven and then forgotten. But here's the rub. We're not there yet, are we? I said this last week, and I'm repeating it this week because it's important. But we're not there yet. We are not fully able to forget those who have hurt us. And those who have hurt us, and here's the problem, those who have hurt us are not able to forget what they did. And that's where the issue lies. See, forgetting takes place on two planes. As the forgiver, we are supposed to forget the sin of those who have hurt us and move on. Give them a new opportunity. Let them do it again. But there's also the one who is forgiven. The prodigal son should forget his wayward ways. You understand that? He should forget what he did and move on to something better. But the trouble is, we aren't there yet. We aren't able, quite often, to learn and to grow and to move on from our mistakes, to move forward. So this is why we continue with a justice system. We have to have it. Because we have to help folks move on when they aren't willing to do so. And sometimes, when they aren't willing to do so, we also have to isolate them so that they don't continue hurting other people. That's the reality of where we are. But our Father, our Heavenly Father, has it down perfectly. He constantly forgives and forgets our sins and gives us a new chance, a new try, a new go. And we see that through Jesus, who died for us. Jesus, who paid the ultimate price for our mistakes. I mean, we think our penitentiary, our justice system is harsh in Canada, where, you know, we put away people for life sometimes. But imagine in the Old Testament times when the punishment could be death. And theoretically, the punishment even for sin was death. But Jesus overrode that. Jesus, through his death, made sure that our sins were paid for. But more than that, he changed how we look at and understand God. Because there used to be, well, there still is, a strict law system in place, right? The Ten Commandments, believe it or not, are still in effect. They are not suggestions. They are not just to be posted on the wall in fancy crochet so we can say, oh, isn't that nice? Look at all the work put into making that. They still work. But the way that we deal with them has changed. It's not a question of justice leading to death, because it's no longer a matter of this heavenly judge and his subjects. In today's second reading, Kathy told us about a change in relationship in my God's house, in my king's house, in my owner's house, in my master's house, in my boss's house, in my father's house, in my father's house. Two important words there. Because in the Old Testament, it would have been in my Lord's temple. In my God's holy place. But Jesus said, in my Father's house. What do you think of when you think of a house? But a place of warmth, of welcome. Where dad sees you coming down the laneway after you've blown it, and he welcomes you, and he meets you halfway, and he brings you inside, and he says, let's have a party. Nice to have you back, kid. A house where you gather together, and there's joy, and there's frustration, where there's dirty dishes that don't get done because those darn kids never do them. But then there's a tie on the wall. You know, the cardboard tie that Junior made when he was 3 years old, and it's roughly cut out, and there's 17 pounds of white glue on it, and there's more glitter than they could hold in more dollar stores. But your kid made that when he was 3 years old for you, and you've never forgotten it. There's the macaroni portrait of Dad done by Little Missy. Remember those? Yeah. Again, 17 pounds of white glue. And then a big macaroni piece for each eye. Oink, oink. And then, of course, there was, you know, the nose. And then something roughly resembling a smile. You know, little all the curvy macaronis, and they're all carefully, artfully placed. And then, of course, the spray paint, right? You know, gold and silver and a beard with black spray paint. And then when you take the plate off the table, oh, now the dining room table has a permanent image because there's gold spray paint and there's silver spray paint and there's black silk spray paint and 16 pounds of glue. And macaroni stuck all over it. But little Missy made it when she was 4 years old. And that table is the most important table in my house. And that's what Jesus is saying. in my Father's house, in my Father's place where you are welcome, in my Father's place where we gather together and sometimes there are stern lectures. Young man, you are not supposed to use BB guns in order to say Happy Father's Day on the garage wall. Nice try, but please don't do that again. Young lady, when you back the car out of the garage, two things. A, make sure the parking brake is off, and that the garage door is fully open. That's what happens in a house, right? The great things and the mistakes, the warmth and the welcome. As I said before, it's a struggling passage because then Jesus goes on and says, there are many rooms. And it's about the only time he ever says that. We don't know what it means, okay? I'm going to tell you right now, we don't know fully what that expression means. Does it mean that everybody gets their own individual room? Be a big house. I mean, right now we're at 6 or 7 billion and counting. Imagine that. Or does it mean that each of us has a welcome in it? Does it mean that our Heavenly Father is rich beyond imagination? Because remember, houses back then would have had 4 rooms at most. You wouldn't have your individual room. You would have, Junior and Little Junior and Red and Little Red and Missy and Missy's sister, and I can never remember her name unless I say them all in order. Yeah, that game. You know, and you've got 12 kids in one room, and then you've got parents in the other room with the babies and the kitchen. And so to say that there are many rooms, is our Heavenly Father fabulously wealthy? I think what he's saying is that there's a place for everybody. Our Father's house is big enough to accommodate us all. That's the bottom line. And then he goes on to say something extraordinary. Something that flips the prodigal son story on its head. Because in the case of the prodigal son story, what happens? The prodigal gets lost and he returns. Meanwhile, Jesus says, in my Father's house, there are many rooms, and I'm going to go prepare a place for you. And then I'm going to take you there. I'm going to take you there. He's going to be the one leading us. He's going to be the one walking with us. And think of the prodigal son story. What happens to the prodigal son? Where does his father meet him? Does he wait for him in the house? Even before he's home, the father runs out, and the father takes the son into the house. Changes that story a little bit, doesn't it? The father meets the son and takes him back in with him. Jesus prepares a place and takes us there with him. God meets us halfway. And what are the conditions for God meeting us there? Are any of us deserving to be with God? Anybody led a perfect life? But what does the Father do? He forgives the prodigal and he forgets. And what does Jesus help our Heavenly Father do? He helps our Heavenly Father forgive us and forget. And then he welcomes us. He takes us into his home. Really simple story, isn't it? And what about the brother? Where's the brother left at? Well, we have to remember. We have to acknowledge the brother. We have to realize that you don't want to be the brother. The brother is an illustration of us in our imperfection, in our unforgiveness, in our unforgetting. The brother has to be mentioned in that story to remind us of the reality and the contrast between the father. The brother is where we were, where we are, where we might be. The brother is an illustration of what not to do. That's why he's there. That's why we have to acknowledge him. That's why we can't leave him out of the story. Because if you identify with the brother, if the first words out of your mouth are, "Darn right! That brother, that's the key to the story. That brother is right. Father should have treated him to a party. Father should have treated him specially. He was the faithful one." But if that's where your heart lies, you've missed the point of the story. Because you've missed the forgiveness. And you've missed the forgetting. So I leave you with a choice. I leave you with your own decision. Now I realize I'm going to have to expand it out. So imagine the brother as also being a sister, because I want to include everybody. So we'll say the sibling, okay? And I realize it's Father's Day, and we want to honor fathers, and we use this father imagery for our God as well. But because I don't want to leave anybody out, I'll say the parent. So the parent goes out and meets the child and brings him back in and forgives and forgets. The sibling holds a grudge. And I'll end it here with a question. Are you the parent or are you the sibling? Amen. I invite you to pray with me. Our prayer is on the overhead. You get the dark, bold, italicized part at the bottom. Let's pray. For those who have fathered us into birth, for those we call Father because they have shown us the face of our Father in heaven, for expectant fathers and those whose arms ache to cradle their own, for fathers who have borne the pain of losing a child, and for fathers who have laid down their life for their children.
May the one who is Father and Lord of all be their guide and their peace. We pray to the Lord.
For all who have been deprived of their fathers through war, violence, or imprisonment, addiction, divorce, or separation, for those whose fathers have left home in search of work in another land,
may their wounds be healed and their families mended together, we pray to the Lord.
For foster fathers, stepfathers, and fathers by adoption,
that they will find true happiness in the mystery of fatherhood, and that their love for their children may bind them closer into the perfect love of God, we pray to the Lord.
For those we call Father, for those who showed us how to throw a ball or cook a meal, those who taught us how to drive and showed mercy upon us for the dents, those who kissed away our hurts, calmed all our fears, and protected us as best they could,
we pray to the Lord.
For all fathers, living or dead, those nearby or those distant by miles, disease, or division, that they all may be embraced and strengthened by the loving arms of God, the Father of us all. Amen. Please rise for a benediction. May God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you this day and forevermore. And together we say, Amen. Amen. We're going to sing. And you can sit if you want, or you can stand if you want. There was a stand. We're going to sing.
Actually, I have an annotation to John's invitation to sit or stand for this particular piece. You're welcome to dance in the aisle.
Thank you. That's pretty late.